Welcome to When Podcast Rules the Game, the recognized symbol of excellence in Scorpions podcasting.
Then, oh wait, oh yeah.
There you go.
Okay, then what's your other line, Nick?
Then, now, and forever.
Forever. There it is. All right, that's about as far as we can go with that joke, right? I think. Beginning, middle, and end of When Podcast Rules the Game. Welcome to Pod of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting. It is episode 200, the bicentennial, if you will. How about that?
Yeah, the combination of that and the proximity to April Fool's, we kind of had the idea to do a debut episode of a Scorpions podcast. Make like we were abandoning the KISS theme, but just didn't have the energy or the time to put that together.
No, but that was good enough, right? I think that was good.
Yeah. Plus, I was seeing online today is the I don't know the number, but it's the anniversary of the release of the Animal Magnetism album.
Okay.
With one of those trademark weird covers.
Is that the one with the gum? The chewing gum?
No, it's the woman on her knees next to a Doberman. Yeah. And the guy, it's some guy's waist, and he's got his hand in his back pocket or something.
It's provocative. How about that?
They've always had those. Just the weirdest album covers.
And UFO had similar album covers, which makes sense given the Michael Schenker connection there. I think, again, here's proof of the spontaneity and unrehearsed nature of this podcast. You know, if we were planning ahead, I could have Googled it to see if it's the same guy who does all the album covers.
Right.
But, you know, that's not what we do. We don't come up with a plan and Google stuff and then portray ourselves as knowing everything about music. We just come in here and shoot from the hip. I would be surprised if it wasn't the same guy who did a lot of those UFO covers as well. Have you seen some of those? Like Heavy Petting and things of that nature.
I'm not as familiar with the UFO covers, I'll have to admit.
Yeah, they're equally weird.
I can only imagine I point to Love Drive as being maybe the weirdest album cover that I can think of. That's the one with it looks like gum coming off the woman's breast and like the back of a limo for some reason.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Well, there's only one way to find out if it's the same artist.
Look it up! Look it up! Oh! Look for it right now!
Right. So we do this kind of research right in front of your ears out there. You know, we don't have production meetings. We don't look on the calendar and be like, hey, it's the day that Animal Magnetism came out, so let's talk about the album cover and make a connection to the UFO album covers, and then we'll spout off about how we know it's the same guy or not and portray ourselves to be all-knowing when, you know, it's just not how we operate. And we don't know anything about anything, really.
No. I would like to pose it to listeners, just in case if they wanted to let us know what they think might be even a weirder. I'm not talking like a more explicit or like perverse cover. I'm just seeing a weirder kind of cover than like the Love Drive album. Or, I mean, there's really nothing, like no skin being shown, but yeah,
the woman on her knees gazing up at the guy who's got his hand in his back pocket. And there's a Doberman sitting there.
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to see that in Target, you know, on the end cap, any popular new groups of the day with an album cover like
that.
Well,
they don't. That's the other thing is bands aren't putting out any material that's going to have a cover.
No.
You know, that's another article I saw today was how streaming is just taking over the music industry. And in fact, today I put up that Bob Seger post And one of the podheads said, quite frankly, if it's not on Spotify or Apple Music, I'm not listening to it. This is a man who is 100% streaming.
There you go.
So, you know. And then our other podhead, the esteemed Kelly Lincoln, was it him or was it somebody else? Maybe, I'm sure he would agree with this sentiment if it wasn't him, but I think I saw a post from another friend of mine talking about the whole, you know, album artwork, liner notes, blah, 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 that people are missing out on nowadays. And, you know, the younger generations aren't really missing out on it if they never experienced it. So,
yeah, but I have a feeling that once a generation like that would discover it, it would become it would come into fashion.
You would hope, but there are just so many more distractions and so many things competing for people's attention that you wonder if they would give a damn about it. So what'd you find, Andy?
I found all the answers that we would ever want. And I have a feeling, based on looking at what I've found, that there are probably a lot of listeners who knew the answer to this.
Well, of course, yeah. We don't inform anybody of anything on this show.
We're asking questions.
We sit here and shoot the shit, and for some reason people seem to be entertained by it. But again, we're not portraying ourselves to be anything other than what we are, just three jackasses sitting around talking about music.
So
no production meetings on this show.
None. So what I found out, you were absolutely right. The connection between, what was it, Love Drive, Animal Magnetism, and No Heavy Petting.
No Heavy Petting, okay.
Same guy, yeah.
What an album title, by the way.
Is that the only UFO album he did?
No, I believe he did all of them. I don't know.
Oh, well, there you go.
I can't
12?
Can't get over that album title.
Oh, 9. He did 9. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, No Heavy Petting.
And who is this individual?
So this guy, Storm Thorgerson.
Okay.
This guy has done like every album cover you've ever seen in your life. Dark Side of the Moon.
Really?
This guy's done everything. He's done Dirty Deeds, done Dirt Cheap.
Okay, that's similar in theme to what the ones we're talking about. Dark Side of the Moon doesn't seem to fit the mold.
So he can get serious when he needs to. Otherwise, he just gets buck wild on German band covers.
Yeah. He did Anthrax's Stomp 442.
Okay.
I'm not naming everything. I'm just naming things that we might be interested in.
I can see from across the room. It's
an enormous list. Audio Slave album with that little flame thing outside.
Oh, wow. He's been around doing albums for a long time.
Bunch of Bad Company, a couple Black Sabbaths, Technical Ecstasy, and Never Say Die.
Okay, those are definitely two of their most out there album covers.
Yeah. Technical Ecstasy particularly, yeah.
And then he did Bruce Dickinson's Skunk Works.
He didn't do Balls to Picasso.
No, someone else do that.
He didn't do the one with what's the one that I have at home, the CD with the Evil Jester on it.
Oh, Accident of Birth?
Yes, Accident of Birth. He did not do that one?
Nope.
That's too bad.
He did some David Gilmour stuff. He did High and Dry, Def Leppard.
Oh.
Dream Theater, 4 of their albums.
Great.
Oh, he did some ELO. Four of those.
Cut it off.
Well, I'll just name a couple of the high-end ones. I won't go through the list.
There are no high-end ELO albums.
No, not ELO. I mean other artists he worked with.
Okay, good. I was going to say, every ELO album is garbage.
Nothing good? They have nothing to offer?
They have nothing. They're worse than Slade. How's that grab you?
Well,
I won't disagree there, but
you've made it seem like Slade doesn't have much to offer either, so
their logo is a fucking Simon game from the 70s, okay? That's how cheesy this band is. Remember that game?
Yeah, with the four colors or whatever.
That's what their fucking spaceship looks like. They suck.
Well, didn't Boston have a spaceship, too?
Yeah, but theirs was cool.
It was shaped like a guitar, man.
Oh,
it was
way
cooler. Don't try to cloud the issue, okay? ELO is one of the worst bands in the history of rock.
Oh, man.
And they're going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame in a couple of weeks. What a joke. What? Terrible. Well,
let's finish this quick thing. Some Genesis stuff.
Oh, which ones?
The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. A Trick of the Tall Tale.
God, how did this guy have time to do all this shit?
Dude, it's a million.
Did he do
Wind and Wuthering?
Did he do Selling England by the Pound?
No.
Oh, just curious.
And then there were three. Move ahead here. He did Halloween, Pink Bubbles Go Ape. He did some Humble Pie. He did Led Zeppelin. He did six of their albums.
Really?
Yeah.
He Presence had to have been one, right?
Presence was one.
Yeah, that's a weird one. It's got the object.
Yeah.
That black thing that's in all the pictures. It's a weird album concept.
It's too small, whatever that is.
It's just like various snapshot pictures, and they've got this black object that's in all of the pictures. Very strange concept.
No, I can't get past No Heavy Petting here.
I knew that would perk you up.
Oh, he did the Megadeth Rude Awakening DVD. That's always been kind of a cool...
With the bed falling out of the...
Falling out of a window. Yeah, off a building.
From, what was the video? Was it Skin of... No.
Was that from a video?
Yeah.
Was it? I didn't even know that.
Yeah, that was from one of their videos.
I did not realize
Or
that.
No, wait. It was Enter Sandman.
Where it gets hit by a semi-truck?
Where it's falling out of a window, right?
Yeah, no? that's not... That's
no, no, no. But there was a video that had that, and then Megadeth had the album covers.
So you're telling me that Storm Thorgerson ripped that off from someone else? I don't believe you.
Well, I don't want to get caught in the
people
storm.
Rip off things from him, not the other way around.
Peter Gabriel, Paul McCartney, Fish.
Did
Pink,
they do that
bunch
weird
of Pink Floyd's?
That weird Peter Gabriel one with the fingernails?
Scratch.
Yeah,
yeah, he did scratch.
He did do that one.
This guy's. He's done everything. Look at that.
That's incredible.
It really
I had no
is.
No idea.
No idea who this guy was, but you
is
actually...
Is he still alive?
No, he died in 2013.
Damn.
We could have had him do the Pot of Thunder 250th episode.
Yeah.
Rainbow.
Which Rainbow? Rising?
Difficult to Cure.
That's an interesting one.
Straight Between the Eyes.
Okay.
Bent Out of Shape.
All right.
Uh-huh. He didn't do any Yngwie albums, did he?
I haven't gotten there yet. Let's see.
Please say he did Trilogy.
Rival Sons, Pressure and Time.
Wow. All right. Cool.
Robert Plant.
Shit. This guy
Sammy Hagar.
Demand. Fuck.
Scorpions.
No idea.
Steve Miller. Styx. A bunch of UFOs. A T-Rex.
No Yngwie.
Wishbone Ash. Wings, XTC.
Wow.
Yes.
This guy was busy.
No Yngwie, unfortunately. So this guy really never made it.
No,
unfortunately, his career was cut short before he hit the big time.
B-list. His never got to the top.
His prime was forthcoming.
Yep. Yeah, that's too bad.
Well.
But
Storm
Thorgerson.
He did okay.
Yeah.
He did all right.
He did a few things of note.
He had a pretty prolific career, but...
He never reached the top of the mountain.
He didn't, and you know what? He never did 200 episodes of a podcast.
200 episodes!
Jesus. It's murky vocals. Sounds like Hotter Than Hell production.
There you go. All right. So, Nick, do you see, is there anybody here? Are we waiting for a delivery?
Oh, he's here.
We're doing it. Okay.
He knows he's got a tux on, actually, today.
Because it's a big day.
Yeah, it's a special occasion.
Right, okay.
He's all set for the big day.
And there is our Double Platinum Club delivery. Nick, what's in the box?
Let's see what's in the box.
I didn't make a clip of that.
That's okay.
A very good Twilight Zone episode, by the way. What's in the box? The cab driver sees his future in the TV. The henpecked husband.
I'm trying to remember.
Well, he's the henpecked husband.
I don't know if that I'm familiar with.
Oh,
that might be one that got away.
He straight punches this woman right in the face and sends her out a window.
Wow.
Falling out the window. Wow.
Maybe that's why I never... Maybe
it's
why
it's
I
a trademark falling out the window, but she is sent that way by a straight right to the face.
Maybe that's,
wow.
Maybe
it
that's
is unbelievable. That you might, would never see that.
That
on
might be
TV
might
nowadays.
Be why yeah they don't show that's it on out of sci-fi.
No, they show it.
Do they?
Yeah.
I just
absolutely.
Missed it.
A straight shot straight to the face, and they show it twice in the episode.
Well, you know, I ordered some stuff, so let's make sure that's the right package.
Oh, my.
Who's this from?
Good? Is it for us?
Yeah, this
okay.
is for us.
Cool. All right. It's from the Double Platinum Club. It's our
so
piece.
So what's this from, technically?
Right, but. Right. But it's our weekly piece of merchandise that will reveal this week's song. But before we find out, Nick,
yes.
What is in the box?
In the box, we have a seasonal sort of, I guess, if you want to call it a holiday, perhaps a holy day.
Ooh,
item.
Easter's right around the corner.
Well,
is that where we're going here?
We're kind of going there.
Okay.
Have you guys seen that the you know the supermarkets usually they just dedicate like a little end cap around this time of year for the Hebrew items, if you will.
Oh yeah, they'll have like
gefilte fish.
Right, right, right. And like the my ignorance, I apologize, but there's like some kind of crackers that are kosher or something. Or
how very interesting that you bring that up.
Uh oh. Okay. Is that
because they're like pretty big crackers, the matzos?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's what it is. Sorry.
The Passover crackers?
Yes.
They're pretty big. They're, I don't know. I never measured, but I'm guessing they're like between 6 and 8 inch square, just huge crackers.
Yeah.
And what we've got here is Kiss is getting in on it. We've had Kissmas.
Yeah.
Now they're getting primed to be selling some rock and Passover matzos.
Oh, boy.
That's nice for Daddy.
But
rock and Passover,
as you can see, obviously, right in front of your four eyes here in this room, excluding mine, you can see that, like their world record-breaking comic book, these are gigantic matzo crackers. They're 36 by 36.
Wow, that big.
They want.
What?
Well, Kiss goes big, right?
So you like that, huh?
You got. Some giant crackers we can all share.
Yeah. Wow. Well, are we? I'm
gonna put peanut butter on.
Is that allowed
for me?
I don't know what the traditional topping is on one of those crackers.
I don't know.
I don't
too
think
much
it
about
matters
it.
If you're not Jewish, right?
Oh my gosh.
I think there's a. I don't know what are there bitter herbs and things like that that
bitter
are
herbs
part of.
That could be fun.
I'm making that up. I don't really know exactly all the traditions or even approximately. But, yeah, I'm going to put peanut butter on mine.
Well, Nick.
We're always trying to do something special and spectacular.
So well, go ahead and put peanut butter on your matzo cracker.
The size of this matzo is spectacular.
Is it not, it's 36 inches?
Yeah. They're going for the record here.
That's a yard of matzo.
That's 9 square feet of matzo.
It's unbelievable.
It's typical horse shit when you're dealing with the Jones brothers.
Yeah, that's right.
Unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
Did we ever talk about, did you remember the Dominator from Domino's Pizza? It was like a...
I remember the Noid.
The Noid, I remember.
Now,
the Dominator.
The Dominator was actually a pizza. It was a square pizza. It was rectangular.
Yeah.
And the slogan on the side of the box is, "It's almost a yard of pizza."
That's pretty good.
Yeah. Maybe do a Google image search. Somebody might have a picture of that. But I remember that when that came out, just that slogan. Is that really something that somebody would want?
Pizza.
I don't know.
Andy's probably going to want it to bring up the same story.
I know what you're
but I'll
say.
Do it.
You'll do it better.
Our old band, we had, I don't know, just being silly at the show. I think didn't we have like a contest or something where there was a prize?
Sounds
someone in
like
the crowd could
do.
Win something. It was, I think we got it from like Menards, which is, you know, I guess you can get food from Menards. Why not?
Sure.
It was the...
if you can get the entire Good Time series on DVD, you can probably get food there.
While you're watching the entire series, you could be polishing off the 3-pound yard o' beef summer sausage, which made me laugh because it wasn't 3 foot long. It was 3 pounds.
3 pounds.
So yeah, close enough. Pound to feet ratio is 1 to 1.
Yeah, whatever.
You could slice it thinner and make it 3 feet.
You got the message across.
Yeah, 3 of anything is a yard. It doesn't matter. Yeah. There's a yard of hosts doing Pot of Thunder right now. 3 of us.
It works.
Yeah.
It should be a lot of fun.
There you go. So, how... You said something about a contest, and it just got me sidetracked again because I've been thinking about this.
That's what we do.
And it keeps making me laugh every time I think of it. But a band that Nick and I were in 2001, I found a set list from a show we played. And I really don't have much memory of this, but I saw it on the set list. And it had like two things together, like something slash something.
Like a medley.
Yes. And the medley that we chose to do was Fast Car by Tracy Chapman with a burping contest in the middle of it.
I mean, that's what she used to do in her show.
Well, that must be where we got it from.
But I'm thinking.
It's like, I don't even think I remember doing that, but I loved reading that was an idea that we thought was good.
What
but
do we do after half of Fast Car?
Let's keep the song going and have a burping contest. That's good entertainment. Okay, so how do we take these 3-foot by 3-foot crackers, put peanut butter on them, and make them... generate a random song to celebrate.
If you took two of those crackers, you could do the 2 zeros. So what would be the 2?
The yard of beef.
Yeah.
3 yards of beef.
Yeah, just
to make
bend
a 2.
It around to make it a 2. That would be good.
Yeah. Okay. Is that allowed?
Well, we're gonna chop up.
We should have gotten a couple of hot and ready's and some crazy bread and arranged the crazy bread in the shape of a 2.
Oh well.
See, again, this shit occurs to us. If we prepared for these things ahead of time, we'd have done exactly that. But yeah.
Well, we encourage listeners to go buy crazy bread and 2 pizzas and send us pictures.
If a 300th episode is possible, then we would have done that.
Yeah.
I don't know that Kiss is going to come out with 40 more songs.
Right, yeah. Well, let's focus on what's happening right now, Nick. How does this food product generate a song?
Well, I have to go start up the old random song generator.
You do, okay.
Here I go.
Fired right up.
No problems.
No problems. All right. So, what happens now?
What happens now is I'm going to use the gluten test interface that comes with... this is actually a standard
thing.
I didn't add this to the sports machine.
It just comes with it.
Yeah.
It's a standard.
Apparently,
item.
George Michael is just very, very conscious of people around him possibly having celiac disease.
Right, yeah.
So...
Okay. Well, good.
So yeah, we're gonna check the. I don't know. Is it what is it? 20 units per million. However you do that.
Okay.
I don't know.
That's above my head.
Yeah, there's some. I have it written down over here. I'm gonna do a little test. I imagine this cracker will have a little gluten in it.
Well, let's do that test.
This 9 square feet of cracker might be able to find a trace of gluten.
This one comes off.
Crazy Nights.
It's called
When Your Walls Come Down.
Oh boy.
Off of Crazy Nights.
All right.
Some people in this room particularly.
A minute ago when you said this cracker, I thought you were talking about a white guy. So I was like.
9 square feet of white.
Yeah, right.
That's about right for this room. Okay.
Speaking of white, we have a Crazy Nights track.
Kiss Behind the Mask. There's a quote from Bruce Kulick. There's really not much to say about this song in the book, but there's one short quote. Let me read
it. That's good. We don't like the long-winded bullshit.
Yeah, sometimes there's too much.
And,
Who is this again?
Yammering on about stuff.
This is Bruce Kulick. I remember having a couple of verses, kind of Van Halen-like bouncy things. Okay. Paul liked it. We sat down and worked on it. I wasn't around when he finished the song with Adam Mitchell.
Oh,
that's all.
What
we have.
Does that mean?
So,
are there implications there?
I mean, might have to bring that up at the expo. So, are you still pissed off that you weren't around for the ending of the writing of When Your Walls Come Down?
Yeah.
So it's still stuck in your craw.
Can you just vent in front of us right now about that?
Well, he did get a songwriting credit, so he can't be too mad. But Adam Mitchell, Paul Stanley,
Bruce Kulick. Is Adam Mitchell?
Adam Mitchell wrote some stuff on Creatures, didn't he?
Adam Mitchell.
He's kind of a veteran in the Kiss camp.
Is a Scottish guy.
Oh, great.
Who did some work on Killers, Creatures of the Night, Crazy Nights, and Hot in the Shade.
Yeah.
Is Killers, is it like Dynasty where we're just not getting any more tracks?
There's not much to get.
What? Well,
there's like, what, two songs, three songs?
Four.
Oh, are there four?
Yeah.
Okay.
There are four, and we haven't gotten any.
Well, no, we got one.
Did we? Oh,
Down
we
on
did.
Your knees.
We did. Yeah. Holy crap. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Killers, the Killers tracks are interesting to me because I never really gave them much of a shot.
Yeah.
Maybe because it's not a full album of all new material.
Yeah, it's 12 songs, 8 old ones, 4 new ones, one of those deals. Sort of a greatest hits situation. But
who else has Adam Mitchell wrote songs for?
It's an interesting question.
UFO, Scorpions?
Yeah.
There's only one way to find out. Okay.
Not really that interested, but go
ahead.
That's
too bad. Oh, we got...
Doesn't he have a line of lipstick? Adam Mitchell.
No, that's Paul Mitchell, I believe.
Okay.
Close
Fine
enough.
Shampoos at CVS, hair care products.
French Waltz, which was a hit for Nicolette Larson. Don't know that one. Dancing Round and Round, a hit for Olivia Newton-John.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So some real masculine tunage.
Well, then he did go another direction. Merle Haggard. So
that's there you go.
Yeah. Mm. But then Kiss. Wait. Also written songs recorded by blah, blah, blah. Nobody cares. Loser. And Paul Anka.
Well,
Paul Anka, wow.
I don't know which song, but something was...
Instant credibility.
When you wrote something that Anka wants to record, then, because usually he writes whatever,
Right.
He's the... I don't know that he writes everything that he records, but...
One thing we can safely say based on the sound clips is he doesn't suffer fools.
No. Yeah.
So, this guy wouldn't be in his... orbit if he didn't have some competency.
Yep. Well, are you guys ready to get started?
Yeah, I guess so. I'm not. Yeah, I mean,
when your walls.
You don't have the energy for this. What's
going on? It's crazy nights. I don't give a shit about this album.
No?
I'm like the anti-Jericho on this album. He's gonna get up in my grill about it. I'm sure. Whatever. Nothing about this album excites me.
No.
Let me get up here and look at this song list.
Yeah, so there are 11 songs on Crazy Nights. Again, for those of you who don't have this information at the ready, 1987, 11 songs.
Bang Bang You is amusing, Mm-hmm. Reason to Live is okay. Turn on the Night was interesting because we did that with Jericho. I can't say I'm thrilled about the rest of it. So
what about My Way?
I recall, giving Paul his props for the vocal performance, but the song itself was dreck.
Mm.
Not to my liking, if I recall correctly.
Well, 11 songs, this is track 7. So there you have it. right in the middle-ish, sort of.
Middle of side two back in the day when people had albums and whatnot.
What have you. All right. You guys ready?
Might as well get it over with. It's kind of anticlimactic for episode 200.
Well, maybe that's for you. Other people might like it. Let's give it a fair shot.
It's not a slam dunk like it had charisma come out of the damn thing, well, or something from Creatures.
Back to your point you made earlier, this is not a show that we plan. We don't really put special moments together. Whatever happens,
right.
happens,
and
that's what
true.
We get. So.
It's, in the scheme of things, this is anticlimactic. I'm predicting that I'm not going to like this song, but we'll see.
It's like most things in life. You look forward to it for a while, and then it's disappointing.
Yeah, you got that right.
The best moments are usually spontaneous. So there you go.
Well, we'll see.
Nice depressing note before we start the song.
Come down.
If the word walls is a euphemism for labia, then I can get on board with it. But anything short of that is probably not going to do it for me.
That's it, huh? When your labia comes down? Or what is
well, you have your Sheena Easton's Sugar Walls, a song that Prince wrote for her, so kind of in that frame of mind right now.
Prince was so horny, wasn't he?
He was. He'd take it.
He'd take it. He'd give it, whatever.
Yeah.
He didn't care.
Just driven by his loins.
I read an interview after he died where it was a thing about him and Rick James, and they were contentious a lot. And Rick James saying, oh, Prince is not, he's not all there. He's writing about incest and all that stuff. And then in the article they pointed out, yeah, when Rick James is is saying that you're debaucherous up. And you're messed up, then yeah. Then
didn't he light a woman on fire?
I think
kidnapped her. Held her hostage, free-based her.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
Lit her on fire? What the hell?
Career never really recovered.
This has some interesting lyrics. I think, Chris, if nothing else, if you focus on the lyrics, you're going to enjoy yourself.
All right, well, let her rip.
Starts out with Paul screaming labia before the music starts. I thought this was not on Carnival of Souls.
Good one.
It is kind of a bizarre start for a Creatures of the Night song.
It's kind of continuing where we left off last episode. Some interesting.
The ride cymbal work is the intro is reminiscent to me of one of Andy's favorite bands, a band that we both enjoy, the Cult.
Okay.
The beginning of Sun King. It's reminding me of that. Another 80s triumph. Andy's a big fan.
My only issue thus far is that I'm trying to hear what the guitar riff is, and the lead guitar is kind of covering it up.
It's too hot?
It's not too hot. It's just too active, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's like Mark St. John style, which is not what you should aspire to.
I just can't tell what's happening. Like, I'm trying to kind of mentally set myself into this groove here, and I'm not able to.
Yeah, and from that intro, you expect something a little more foreboding, and then suddenly you get the, let's go!
Yeah.
And then this quote-unquote bouncy thing comes at
yeah,
you.
I'm trying to figure out what the Eddie Van Halen-type guitar riff is.
It's not there.
It isn't one.
I just hear how would you call the bass? A bouncy kind of bass in the background.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know what he was
real
talking
bouncy
about there.
Sound,
but I don't really hear it unless you're talking about the Floyd Rose dive bombs and whatnot, which again is, you know, everybody got sucked into that from Van Halen, but that was just a tiny, tiny element of his playing. Most people missed out on all the substance, just went straight for the flash and I think you're getting some of that here.
This is pretty,
Did he really say liar, liar with your pants on fire?
He said, liar, liar, got your pants on fire. I know you want it. You know you want it too.
Okay.
So she's telling him no, but he knows the truth.
Maybe it is about labia, pants on fire.
And you know, liar, you know, that's not a bad... If you're going to have some kind of metaphor, that's pretty spot on for what he's getting at here. You know, I know you want it. Liar, liar, got your pants on fire.
I think that's not bad.
No.
I think there could be, he could have added, like, I smell smoke. Could have been part of the lyrics, too. With the pants being on fire. I'm just saying. What's the sound clip that I'm trying to get to here?
Producer of the year.
I honestly don't have any idea.
I can smell her.
Jesus.
The front row.
I don't know, but I can smell her in the front.
Yeah.
Honestly, I forgot about that clip until you just said it. I'm sorry. I was like, what do you mean I love Shaved Beaver?
He's
I don't
smelling
get it.
Smoke. He's smelling some pants on fire in the front row.
Yeah.
I apologize. It
skipped my mind.
Will you? Yeah. No, go ahead.
Sorry.
Hey, diddle, diddle, when the cat wants to fit up, the kid's gotta give him the moon.
Hold on.
I'm sorry.
Yep.
I didn't make this.
What?
Yeah.
Please clarify
this. This is really happening.
Please,
right now.
Please verify what just happened.
Or
tell me something
get
else.
Get it over with.
Hey, diddle, diddle.
Oh, no.
When the cat wants to fiddle. The kitten's got to give him the moon.
See, this is about the pussy. This is about the labia. I was right.
Yeah. The kitten's got to give
him
the moon.
In the 80s, the euphemism for the vagina was walls. Established by Prince.
And also
Easton collaboration.
And got to give him the moon. That might be some butthole stuff there, too. I don't know.
We're not sure who's.
What was the bit about the moon? I missed it.
Hey, diddle, diddle, when the cat wants to fiddle, the kitten's got to give him the moon. I don't know, give him the moon?
I like that.
Butt stuff.
Oh, boy.
Well, it's all in close proximity, basically.
Sure.
It's just, you know, whatever's down there, I'm having it.
An all-night marathon, whatever I want.
Yeah.
Whatever I
like
find down there, I'm taking.
Okay, I'm enjoying this so far from a kitschy point of view.
Oh, kitschy for
in
sure.
In terms of like, you know, formidable rock or anything like that, definitely not. But it's entertaining in a bang bang you sort of way.
There's a lot there.
There's
have
a lot
to read
happening.
That back. I can't make out any of these lyrics.
This is like a Nitro song.
The only
this is like that Freight Train song where just a million different vocals going on.
The only thing I think I made out was the end. You'll be happy to be losing some sleep or something like that.
That's correct.
Oh, man.
And they say, you got to look before you leap. And... we're going to judge you by the friends you keep.
What?
But you're looking nasty.
I like the you're looking nasty line.
And I'm in too deep.
Yeah.
You'll be real happy to be losing sleep.
Oh, this is just awful.
What?
Lyrically. It's just...
It's
fun, but on the other hand, it's just embarrassing.
So what I think he's saying is... you know,
kinda
usually
that's you could use that term, that phrase to describe the flying errands kind
absolutely,
of
fun, but embarrassing.
Absolutely.
Sure.
I will not deny that whatsoever.
Who, by the way, are back together opening for the Lathrop Pitbull tour this summer.
Yeah, I heard
Thank
about
goodness.
That.
Yeah.
Good news. People have been clamoring for that.
Yeah, it's going to be an epic trek across America.
So I'm just trying to analyze these lyrics quickly. Is he saying, like, you know, they say you got to look before you leap, and we're going to judge you by the friends you keep. But he's saying, like, just leap and don't worry about who you're with, because this is, you're looking nasty and I'm in too deep. I mean, that's what I'm getting. Like, you know, people say things, but let's just, it's kind of that Paul Stanley thing, you know, let's live in the moment.
You're looking nasty line is almost like, at this point, you're so far gone and you've got nothing to lose, really.
Mm-hmm.
It's all psychology.
I guess so. Well, I don't know. How are you interpreting nasty? Like, you look gross? Is that what you're thinking?
No, no. Okay. Like
you're in,
like
you're
lusty and trashy, like what, we're in the Sunset Strip era, just like a nasty, slutty kind of, you know.
That's kind of like the turn on the night theme, where it was like, you know, workaday woman by day and bar slut by night.
Sure,
maybe something similar to that.
Well,
of course, sometimes
thrills in the night, right? Or did you say turn on the night?
It's thrills.
Sorry.
Night, right, yeah.
Oh, okay. Whatever. Same thing.
I heard people yelling at their iPods.
Is thrills in the night on this album or Asylum?
That
was the other one. Yes, Asylum.
Okay.
Asylum, yeah. Well, I was going to say almost Animal Eyes, but no.
Thief in the Night is on this.
Oh, well, yeah.
Turn on the Night is on this.
Crazy.
Can't nights. Keep them all straight. But, you know, similar theme. And then sometimes, you know, as guys sometimes mess up, you say something to a woman thinking she's going to take it as a compliment, and you know, it's just a poor choice of words. Like, you're looking nasty tonight, thinking you're being all hot and sexy, and she's like totally put off by it.
That's
a dicey word to use. On a woman, nasty.
You've got to be the right guy to use a word like that and not have it backfire on you.
Well, and you have to have some sort of understanding of how she's going to take that. You don't just drop that on somebody that you don't know very well.
Yeah.
We were talking about Prince earlier. That's something that Prince could have pulled off, probably.
Yeah, exactly.
With most women, but, right? You know,
because they probably wouldn't understand what he's talking about anyway.
They don't care.
So
they're just
matter.
Happy to be there. He's so mysterious. Interesting, yeah. But, you know, your Joe Sixpack says you looking nasty to a woman. It's not going to work.
Yeah. I think Nick Manning used to drop that word on some of his co-stars, like right after dropping the load.
I think he was talking about himself.
Yeah. I think, what was that, Mary Carey? Wasn't
who
ran for office or some shit.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember he busted one all over her, and then right at the end, he just goes, nasty.
I think I remember that from way back when.
Yeah, he can get it. Guy like him or Prince, they can get away with it.
Those two guys.
Regular schmo, you know, just trying to, see how far he can take it. That's a pretty dicey word to be using on a lady.
If you've never gone down that road, it's not a bad idea for you. Just go on YouTube and just put Nick Manning, because it won't be like pornographic video content, but the audio will be. And it's just the most outrageous yelling of words that don't make any sense. And I don't know.
Yeah, he's one of the all-time greats.
Yeah. It's clearly like a shtick. That's how ridiculous it is. Like yelling Cubs win during an adult film. That kind of stuff. So weird guy.
It's like a stream of consciousness dialogue.
Yeah.
Then about a 5-minute rendition of Go Cubs Go.
I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I don't even know if that guy's still alive.
Is he even still active?
I have no idea. This is information we, you know, looked up online in 2009, probably 2010. So
he's not still active. He hung him up.
Well, he did play Bat Manning in an adult film.
He hung it and them up.
It and them, yeah. Yeah, I'll have to look that guy up after the show. All right, we got a chorus coming up here. Let's get back to the song.
Okay.
This is so...
Chris shook his head and went, oh...
This is some weak fucking this music has no power to it, no punch, no maybe a little melody, but I'm sorry, man. If this is your idea of like potent rock, you're wrong. There's just no fucking power behind this music. This is some weak stuff, man. All right.
There's a lot going on, yeah.
Now, I will say that I like the verses better than the chorus. That chorus was crap and just weak music, but the verses are entertaining. There's some good turns of phrase going on.
You got a you got a script from a Cosmo guide. 15 ways to find a lover. That's in quotes. And
I
capitalized
love that.
Like a title.
Remember those lampooning articles I would do on Cosmopolitan?
Yeah.
Articles on Smoking Jacket?
Yeah.
Those are great. Fucking every month it was the same crap in that magazine.
It was, right? Don't make me chase you, because the author lied. So I'm assuming he's saying, you know, one of the 15 ways to find a lover is to make a guy chase you.
Wow.
And he's saying, don't do that. That's the author lied.
But even back then, that magazine was just putting out horse shit, polluting the minds of the women who read it.
30 years ago.
Yeah.
It's still going strong.
Oh.
You'll get your answers, babe, under the covers.
Yeah, you will.
That's how you find a lover.
Exactly. Not going to read it in a magazine.
Nope. Ready for more?
Yep.
Sorry, I had to stop this.
And
the line that sticks out like a sore thumb so far to me is, I want a love that lasts forevermore.
I want a love to last forever.
Yeah, how does that fit into any of the rest of the lyrics?
Well,
I don't
give
know.
Him, he's going to tell you. Oh,
okay.
My God.
You're reading ahead.
Oh, my God.
Just spill it out there.
Here, I'll just. It's just two more lines.
If it's coming up, then.
Oh, we're still in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I went back like 2 seconds. Okay. So where we were was you say, I want to wait until I'm really sure, and I want a love to last forevermore.
See, this is just.
So that's what she's saying.
She's saying.
Oh, okay. Right. Every woman says that, don't they?
Yes, that's what she's saying.
Okay,
it's
well,
in quotes.
It makes more sense. I didn't realize it was her, he was quoting her.
No. He's saying this is what she's saying.
Okay. Yeah.
This and that and that.
I mean, these lyrics are coming so rapidly. I'm having a hard time keeping up.
Well, the next line is hers also, and then the last thing is Paul's answer to what she's saying, which is making me blush.
Great.
And I'm an adult man in a room with two other adult men. So,
here we go. Say that again. This is...
So the first three lines of this part of the song is like him saying, this is what she's saying.
Right.
And then the fourth one is like his little answer to whatever, you know, like, well, this is what's up.
Right. You know, she's rambling on and between every thought of hers, he's going, and.
Yep. And then the fourth one is his.
The sledgehammer.
Yes.
And that's what we're hearing here.
There's one of hers and then his.
Okay. There's a lot to pay attention to.
It really is difficult.
It's a lot of work on the part of the listener here.
These are my favorite songs to talk about on Pot of Thunder, though. There's a lot going on, a lot of words, things that you kind of glance over the first time.
Musically, we have nothing to say.
No, we don't want to talk about musically. It's among the worst that I've heard from them. There's literally no authority or power in this music. It's terrible.
All right. Well, you ready?
No, but yeah. I got my pride, I got my dignity.
Well, you swallow everything when you're with me. I can't even make out what he said. Can you?
Any guesses from either one of you?
No, that's just a mishmash.
Something
of nonsense.
He said like well and then something something when you're with me.
All right.
Here we go.
I'm going to read it again. You say, I want to wait until I'm really sure. And I want a love to last forevermore.
And something about
and
dignity.
I've got my pride. I've got my dignity. Well, you'll swallow everything when you're with me.
Oh, boy.
Jesus. Yeah, he's really pushing the envelope. Generally, that line of questioning, so to speak, would not work on most women. And again, this is Paul Stanley, but...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
You'll swallow everything when you're with me.
Okay.
Her pride, it's her like dignity,
they said
all out the window.
Yeah.
With
didn't
one
they say
turn
that
in
that scene in Shawshank? Isn't that what the guy said to him?
What, really? I don't remember.
Something like that.
I'm sorry, I don't remember it.
Okay. A few listeners might know what I'm talking about.
Is this like a jail rape scene or
something? Yeah, yeah. I vaguely remember that. I think probably something similar, but.
They got it from Crazy Nights album. Yeah.
That's what they played in the jail over the speakers. During workout hour.
You're welcome now. When you walk come down. When you walk come down.
That little riff after the set, that's might be the worst riff in the entire Kiss catalog. Play it again. I don't even know why I'm asking you to hear it again, but the one that comes after the second line, it's the second utterance of the title. Listen to this crap. Terrible. That, in my estimation, is the worst riff in the entire Kiss catalog. My God, that is terrible. No authority, no power. Awful music. Chaos going on.
I'm still
The kick to the stomach outburst, you know, the ooh.
I still haven't recovered to whatever that, I don't know if it was chromatic, whatever that ascending thing was before the solo started.
Yeah.
I'm not
the
even
come sure. here, baby, I'm about to, and then just some sound effect, I don't know.
It's a lot.
That was
digest.
That was... Absolutely, as far as a Bruce Kulick solo, that's the most manic solo that we've heard, right?
This is the most Mark St. John I've heard from Bruce.
But as far as just...
I would say absolutely,
absolutely
yeah.
No space between anything, just going absolutely bonkers.
Yeah.
This is Bruce doing that.
Yeah, I can't say I'm a fan of it, and I'm a big Bruce Kulick fan, but yeah... This song is really, really not good.
This is honestly,
this is terrible.
I keep thinking of that Freight Train song by Nitro. There's a lot of stuff in common here.
If you're drawing comparisons to Nitro, you're in deep, deep trouble. I mean, I fucking rage about them taking a nod from Loudness, but if you're dipping your toe into the Nitro pool, you are fucked at that point. that could very well be one of the worst rock bands in history. And if you're drawing comparisons to them, you have really lost the plot. This is just... you cannot make a case for this being any good. I mean... The lyrics you can draw some comedic value from, but in terms of like quality rock and roll, this is absolutely not it. Not even close.
And I guess kind of sort of in the same argument of the Loudness Crazy Nights thing, there is the Def Leppard song, When the Walls Came Tumbling Down.
Mm.
Just what album is that?
I think it's on
early stuff.
I think it's on Through the Night. Yeah.
Why don't you look it up? Look it up. I'm not gonna buy.
But there's no way that could be worse than this. So
yeah, it's from On Through the Night.
Then it's probably pretty decent, right? I've actually never heard that album.
It's interesting.
But no, this is really, really not good. Now, what does that mean? Does it mean, like, when she's not around her friends, she's a different person?
Yeah.
Or is there some sort of masturbatory implication going on there?
I think it's she's different. Her walls come down.
So when you're not around your, like, prudish friends, you're kind of a slut.
I don't even know if it's a
nasty slut.
I don't even
nasty.
Know.
Nasty.
I feel like it's just when she's with Paul. That's the way I'm interpreting it. He brings out the nasty animal in her.
Yeah. Generally, you would when you said she's going to be swallowing everything when you're with me. That's another one that, you know, just drop that on some random woman up the bullpen sports bar. See how that works out for you.
Yeah. What are you drinking?
Yeah.
You'll swallow everything when you're with me. What?
You got a few slices of that pizza left.
You're looking nasty.
You're going to swallow it all when you're with me.
You never know. You try these lines, it's probably like 90% no way.
But
10% you're getting taken to the bathroom.
But what
right
song?
Down there.
I don't remember what song it was, but we had a discussion where it was, yeah, if you use these lines and it works, then you might not want the woman. That
no, you well, probably would.
It might end up not being a good idea.
That's a whole other part of the conversation. We're not factoring that in right now. We're just talking if it works or not. We're not talking, you know, quality decision making or anything like
that. No, definitely not.
When your walls come down, when your walls come down, oh, you get so crazy. When your walls come down,
you don't like the owl.
Okay, that was
howling at
that
the moon,
better.
Bark at the moon. Yeah, right there.
Plus that kind of outburst definitely reminds me of Flying Aaron. Something he would drop into the
See, that's
the music.
Andy would have been the one adding that, I have a feeling.
Yeah,
there
well,
was a
either
howl
one.
In there.
They were interchangeable to me at some of most points of the
probably to everyone for a couple of years.
But, yikes. How much time is left on this?
Oh, not much. 17 seconds.
Okay. Oh, man. Oh,
boy. Hold
did
on.
Did he do a meow?
He sure did.
So wait,
this is terrible.
I think he said, "Come here, kitten, meow."
Yeah. Play it again.
Now this was what?
Everything ill-advised in this song.
This was 87.
Yeah.
So 2 years before, same old situation. Here, kitty, kitty.
Oh yeah. There you go.
Just something that came to mind.
Yeah.
One of the greatest live intros of any song ever. But that's for another time. And by greatest, I mean worst.
That's a Tommy Lee intro, right?
Absolutely.
Ugh.
Well, what do we always say?
Painful.
Don't give the drummer a mic.
That album.
Never a
that,
good idea.
Is that Live and Loud? Is that what that is?
I don't know. It probably had a clever title like that.
That Motley Crue album is a perfect example of don't give a drummer a microphone.
Well, and I mean, that's their entire career. He's
yeah,
had a
yeah,
microphone.
Yeah.
So, I mean.
Right. But I'm just thinking of some of the stuff on that album specifically.
Well, that song, I mean, for anybody not familiar, go ahead and look up the same old situation live version with Tommy Lee's brilliant intro.
Oh, here, kitty, kitty. Here, kitty, kitty.
go. Now I can't like same old situation.
Ruined it for you.
See, it's like the whole loudness.
I still like it.
Kiss
but.
Thing. Just borrowing from the worst out there is definitely not a course of action that's recommended.
So I think we should let Chris vote first.
Yeah, it's straight down to hell. With plenty of vigor. This one rivals Boomerang.
As
the bottom of the barrel for me in the entire Kiss catalog. So this is terrible.
Chris coated this in cherries and threw it down the sink.
I was mildly entertained by some of the lyrics throughout, but just that riff after the second stating of the title is
pretty generic.
Is the worst riff in the entire Kiss catalog. You just heard it. Wow. Awful.
Now, you say almost as bad as Boomerang. I'm not trying to make you change your mind, but at least you laughed at this song. Boomerang, there was like no emotion. There was nothing that stuck out.
Yeah, like I said, almost as bad. It's on that level, but I don't know. I couldn't even tell you how Boomerang goes, you know?
Yeah.
So I've zero recollection of it. It was in one ear and out the other, just enough for me to process how shitty it was. But this one's
like this
definitely
next.
On that level.
Yeah. All right.
So, yeah.
Me?
Sure.
I'm sending this one down also. It's For as much as I can appreciate it when, you know, there's silly lyrics, you know, like this, it just, there was too much going on. It was too rapid fire. Too much thinking had to be done on the part of the listener. Musically, it bothered me musically that I couldn't tell really what the rhythm section was trying to accomplish.
Yeah.
Because there was just so much. If there wasn't, like, just insane amount of vocal delivery going on, then you had just the most rapid fire Bruce Kulick solo probably in the whole catalog. I would imagine. I can't think of anything that was this how would you say, something that would just leave you out of breath just listening to it.
Yeah, it's exhausting.
Yeah, and I can't even really comment on like the drums. I guess Eric Carr did a good job because I didn't really notice.
Yeah, the song, yeah, whatever that was.
Yeah, whatever it was. Bass, I don't know, just a real like twangy, bouncy bass sound kind of happening. And
sure.
I don't know. I'm trying to. I don't hate it, but I really just don't like it very much.
Yeah,
I think if it was the same kind of vibe and slowed down a little bit, then maybe I would have been able to appreciate it a little more. But it's just too much. I had to go back to the Nitro thing. It's like listening to a Nitro song.
Yeah,
you don't. The listener doesn't get a break.
Right. And the riffs they're playing, combined with the tempo that they're playing them at, doesn't seem to serve the riffs for, you know, the best way it possibly could.
Like I said, there's no power or authority in this song. Zero that I can detect.
Well, hey, it's my turn to vote. I gotta say, I enjoy this song, but
fuck.
even still.
I thought you were gonna bump it up.
What's
there.
I don't want to say I love this song. I enjoy it. It makes me laugh. But it's not
right,
a good song.
No, absolutely
and
not.
I can't in good consciousness just give it any kind of hallelujah. I can't give too much praise. I mean, in the middle of Creatures of the Night, or excuse me, in the middle of Crazy Nights, it's fun to listen to. But when you just take it out on its own, listen to it isolated, it's like, what the hell's going on here?
It's terrible.
I hope your buddy Jericho doesn't get too upset with you. Send you an angry message because I don't know. Isn't this his? His album, one of his albums that
I don't know if they're all. We'd have to find out if they're all
this particular song. Yeah,
yeah.
Too bad we didn't draw this one when he was around. I guarantee you that would have blown apart the conspiracy theory that we're kissing up to Jericho and that we like whatever he would like.
Right.
There is no way I would stoop to the level of saying I like this song under any circumstance.
A gun to your head.
No.
You'd say, all right, I had enough.
No.
I lived enough. Hell.
No. No, he could... He could punch me in the face and send me reeling back through the closest window, and I still wouldn't say I like it. This is terrible.
After wrestling all night and then listening to this, there's just no energy to attack anybody. So
unquestionably bottom three. I don't think there's any dispute about it.
Not just on this album, out of anything?
Of the whole catalog, I guess.
Okay. How about that?
This Boomerang and the other one that I remember that we hated was It Never Goes Away off Carnival Souls.
Okay. Yeah.
Those are the bottom three in my estimation.
Wow.
Well, this one gets to go on the All Hell's Breaking Loose Spotify playlist.
Yeah. There you go.
Congratulations.
How many songs are on that playlist now?
I don't know. I have to look into that. I've actually never listened to that one. I need to check it out.
That might be an interesting list.
Yeah.
But
it's a funny idea.
Toss this one on there. It's terrible. Jeez.
Well, hey, if you disagree.
That's just the fucking way it is.
There you have it.
Wow.
What a way to ring in.
200 episodes.
All right, so we like to try new things around here, don't we?
Yeah.
I think we do. Let's give this a try. So,
yeah, I don't even know if it's worth it to seek out YouTube comments about this shit.
Yeah, let's skip that for today.
So I don't want to talk about that song anymore. is the new thing I have to do with the song?
No, it doesn't.
Good.
It does not.
I ever want to consider this song again. Really terrible. If you can make a case for this, good luck to you, but this is garbage. So I'm done talking about the song now.
So here's what we got. This is a new possible new segment we're going to try. We could open it to all listeners, see if it goes anywhere. But one of our listeners named Anthony Corby asked me a couple questions on Facebook. And it was more like, what are your guys' thoughts on the following topics, specifically Chris and Nick? So these aren't even necessarily like specific questions. It's almost like I'll name something and you can just tell me your thoughts on what I'm telling you. But I've got three items for today.
Okay.
How did these inquiries come your way?
This guy Anthony on Facebook tagged me on these Ultimate Hard Rock post about some news and music. Like, oh, okay. What do you guys think about this? Or
But he tags you, but not me or Nick.
Maybe he's not friends with you guys. I don't know what the deal is.
Oh, that could be it.
But, hey, it's my job to get answers for people who have questions.
So, if we move forward with this, just send your questions or whatever directly to Andy.
There you go.
So me and Nick don't know what they are.
Yeah.
Private message him, tag him only, whatever. And then he'll forward those things over to the... this side of the room.
Yep. Okay. So, again, we've got three things.
Are you down with that?
Yeah.
We've got three topics.
Send three topics or questions. It's got to be three.
There you go. Yeah, it's got to be a yard of questions.
Yeah, right.
Or topics. Yes.
So, is this, what are you calling this? Do you have a name for this segment or no?
This is the Ask Nick and Chris lightning round. I don't know. What do we? It's some kind of lightning round. It needs to be a lightning round.
Okay.
It could be short. It could be long. I don't know what it's going to be. I don't know what your reactions are. I might say something.
The Yardo lightning.
Yes.
Round.
The Yardo lightning round. I could say something. Your reaction might be, I don't know. I don't. I don't care. That might be it.
Yeah.
So
before you hear the thunder, it'll be over.
Yep. So we're gonna give it a shot and see how this goes.
Okay.
Here we go. All right. First topic. Your thoughts, your opinions, anything positive, negative, neutral on the Bee Gees.
Very positive from me.
From Nick.
Yes.
I remember working at a books/music store. They had some kind of a greatest hits anthology double disc thing that we used to play in the store.
Mm-hmm.
Got very much turned on to them. Not like a huge fan where I know all their stuff, but Bee Gees, absolutely good in my book. There you go.
Big fan of the disco era, their earlier stuff, just cheesy pop garbage of the time.
It was like almost like 60s pop folk kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, just titles are like tip of my tongue. I can't enunciate them, but I hated them.
Yeah.
But big fan of Saturday Night Fever. I mean, there's some people rag on the disco era unnecessarily. There was some good pop songwriting and, more importantly, some pretty good musicianship on those tunes.
Sure.
So the hatred for disco is just kind of stupid. I never fully understood it. And we've talked about that before. It's like, if you don't like it, change the channel. There was so much good rock in the 70s. You didn't have to pay attention to disco.
Yeah, you don't have to focus all
disco
your
disco wasn't
energy.
Killing anything.
Yeah.
Just ignore it if you don't like it. But.
Well, and to kind of go to back it up from the disco era, what do you think about the song particularly, Lonely Days, Lonely Nights? Like, you know, the Where Would I Be Without My Woman? You know that one?
I don't know that one.
It's very, I guess, it's cliche to say it's Beatle-y, but it is Beatle-y. But really, just a really good song.
Is it on Saturday Night Fever?
No, it's before that. Oh. I think it's called Lonely Days. Mm. I don't know. It's the chorus is Lonely Days, Lonely Nights, Where Would I Be Without My Woman? Song I enjoy very much. So.
Yeah.
Shows a different side of what they were capable of.
Yeah, I don't know. Half and half for me.
All right, next one's something we've kind of talked about, actually pretty extensively, but hey, it's one of the articles that we were tagged in, so I believe it was an on-this-day kind of situation. Phil Collins replaces Peter Gabriel in Genesis. What are your thoughts about that happening? Do you have... What do you have to say about Genesis, each era? I don't know. Where do you want
to
take this?
That's a lot to talk
it
about.
It is. So maybe just specifically on the Phil Collins replacing Peter Gabriel.
It's I would say it's a unique and very cool move that they pulled by doing that. I mean, that was, you think about years later, the whole Dave Grohl thing.
Sure.
You got the drummer coming to the forefront being the star.
I'd never
been on the same band.
Well, no, but yeah, I mean, this is it's a little different, but it probably came out of nowhere when people first heard it. Really? That's the drummer? He's the lead singer now?
Yeah.
I don't know. What can I mean, how many millions and millions of albums did they sell with him at the front? So, as far as the material, I probably like more of the Peter Gabriel stuff, but I can't knock Phil Collins either. I know there were eras of his stuff where he gets, you know,
the Easy Lover stuff.
Whatever, yeah, that or
I like Easy Lover.
I don't mind
actually.
It either. But compared
some
to
energy in that.
Well, he did like
it's a hot. It's
like a Disney
distorted
soundtrack. Like Disney hot. Soundtrack stuff. That stuff's kind of awful.
Oh,
Tarzan or whatever.
Yeah, but
Buster soundtrack. Get out of here with that. Remember that shit?
I don't know what that is.
He starred in a movie called Buster.
Oh.
Fuck off with that. God, get out of here.
I have
That's when it was like too much Phil Collins. It's like, you're not a fucking movie star. Get out of here.
I actually have a VHS of Frauds that he starred in.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I remember that.
Frauds or Frogs?
No, Frauds. Like, it's about like insurance fraud.
Yeah, no. Sorry. You're not a fucking matinee idol. Get out with that, you fucking twerp. Christ.
Chris, do you have any thoughts on the replacement?
I can honestly say that there's that from the Peter Gabriel era, there's nothing that I either know or like.
Wow.
So of the two eras, I would prefer the Phil Collins era, but just generally lukewarm on Genesis, although I did see them in concert because one of my best buddies worships Genesis.
Hmm.
So I saw them on the the tour of the self-titled album with all the sort of geometric shapes on it. Mamo was on it.
Yes.
It was a good show. I mean, you know, good light show and all that stuff. It was entertaining concert, but Genesis just doesn't do it for me.
I think that loop needs to be longer next time because we're almost out, but there's one more topic.
Well, hit it from the beginning again if you want.
Let's do it that way. That sounds fun.
People are missing that intro riff.
All right, one more time.
So work in progress, a new feature. Where have I heard those drums before?
I've never heard.
I don't know how he's hitting the cowbell and doing that double time thing on the hi-hat.
He's got three arms.
All right. I don't know what kind of special rig Andy's got going there.
Hit it with my head.
Like a Rick Allen kind of thing with his feet, too.
There you go. All right. Third and final topic for today. And it's funny, Chris kind of mentioned this earlier in the show. ELO being inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and specifically the news item that drummer Bev Bevan won't be joining Jeff Lynne for the reunion. He has some gigs booked already, so he won't
love that actually.
So he's not going to make it for the big reunion. ELO in the Hall of Fame.
In the Hall of Fame or the specific news item?
I mean, the article was about the fact that the drummer won't be joining Jeff Lynne at the Hall of Fame.
I love that. Love that. Fuck him.
Because Jeff Lynne's the guy, he's where all your hatred's directed, more so than
Well, it's
else.
His band. I don't care what they call it or whatever. It's his fucking brainchild. He runs the show. It's terrible. Bev Bevan, of course, played in Black Sabbath on the Born Again tour.
Oh, there you go.
So that's a so plus Chris, in his column.
Chris is going to take his side any day.
Yeah, well, of course. But and when you think about whatever gigs that Bev Bevan has booked nowadays, they ain't going to be that great.
Yeah.
So the fact that he's picking those over the Jeff Lynne show, I love it.
Well, it's over the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
You know what?
Yeah, but it's, again, it's the Jeff Lynne
show.
Right,
right, right. But I mean,
his fucking afroed ass is going to be up there soaking up all the accolades. And Bev Bevan clearly doesn't want to be involved in that. Fuck him.
That could make this guy a bit of a folk hero, really.
I love it. I had no idea that was like he was doing
like
it.
Like a fighting people's champion kind of guy, you know?
Right.
Read that headline again or whatever. Just, I love this.
It said, ELO drummer Bev Bevan won't be joining Jeff Lynne at Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He has some gigs booked.
He's playing a wedding.
Yeah.
He's got an open mic set going on that night and you can't miss. Love it.
Nick, your thoughts?
About just that situation?
Yes.
Well, about that specific situation.
Oh, well, this could almost be a Rorschach test thing. If it takes your mind somewhere else, you can feel free to do that too.
No, I don't really have much else to say except for that gives this guy really a lot of integrity. Like, if you're reading just that.
Yeah.
Like, this guy would rather be out playing music than have people give him an award about the music he played.
Like, I'll take
it. He'd rather be actually out there playing it.
He's the only other member of the band that anybody could name, okay? Nobody knows the name of the fucking cello player who was up there. That was the other thing. They had a little string section going on.
Like, permanently? Like,
with that.
On the stage? Not just on an album, on a song or two.
It was a whole orchestra part. Right. They had fucking strings, like regular guys in the band. Fuck off with that. God, so lame. Worst.
What was the name of the album you bought?
Out of the Blue, double album.
Not cheap.
Complete garbage. Smashed it in my driveway in disgust.
My favorite
story.
It's true, man.
Did you tell anybody that you were going to, or that you were, I hate this album, I'm going to go break it, or was this just
completely
a solitary experience?
Were you trying to shock a friend?
No.
You were alone.
No, it was by myself.
I mean, that's even better.
That's
Chris,
like
you're like the Bev Bevan of destroying 8-track tapes.
It's true.
You didn't care who saw it.
You got sucked into the ELO hype, and I went and bought it. What a waste of money! It was like $12 too, man.
Right.
You weren't trying to grandstand for the neighborhood.
Right. You were just doing it for you.
Good for you.
And it was an 8-track, so I couldn't fast forward through anything. I had to endure it until I finally couldn't take it anymore.
Did you even put the second tape in?
No, I don't think so.
So that one was just destroyed. Yeah. You know, you didn't even give it a chance.
It was a hot summer day. I just smashed it in the driveway.
Your mom
kicked the remnants into the nearest flower bed.
Your mom probably found it.
Yeah, this is terrible shit.
Yeah.
Fuck them.
Might have been good for the roses, though.
You know. Some kind of fertilizer. It was shitty, right?
Something that magnetic tape, I don't know. But no, it was garbage. Terrible. Bravo to Bev Bevan. I have some gigs booked. I love that. And again, what kind of gigs is Bev Bevan playing? Okay. That on the surface you would say, okay, he can't pass that up for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That's pretty funny.
Does Bev Bevan have a website? You should look up his schedule.
Yeah, I'd like to
see where he's playing.
Where he is.
What is the night of the Rock Hall of Fame? Is it the 14th or something like that?
Let's see. I'll look that up.
All right.
And Andy can look up what Mr. Bevan is up to.
BevBevan.com. Anything?
He's got a Facebook. Bev Bevan News. Events. Upcoming events.
What's the night of the induction, Nick?
He's got no upcoming events.
it's not even true that he's got gigs booked. That makes it even better.
So does he hate Jeff Lynne or what?
Know.
I mean,
what it says here.
I have some gigs booked. In this case, it means he's putting up some drywall at his daughter's house or something like that, you know?
Oh, boy. So it doesn't matter when the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is.
Well, if you have it, you could tell me.
April 7th.
April 7th, so that's
this week.
This week, shit.
Give me a minute here. We might run out of time again.
Oh, that's okay. It's not quite so rapid fire as it was in the beginning.
Well, it is what it is.
Well, you said he's got no upcoming events. I mean, that's it, right?
Well, that was his Facebook. I just wanted to see the actual article, if it said further in the body of what he was doing. I don't know if I'm going to be able to find it in time. Maybe not.
Well, it's probably just a better story that he has nothing.
Oh, hold on. I did find the articles, but
it does fade out.
We'll give it 1 second here. Is there anything interesting here? Oh, stupid ads. I don't need X spiked up look.
Wait a minute. The Bev Bevan Band tour dates and tickets. I've got over here.
Okay. Oh, here we go. I got something too.
Yeah, nothing until October on this list.
Really?
Yeah.
Here's what I see here. Bevan broke the news with a recent Facebook post explaining that he has prior commitments with UK television personality Jasper Carrot. These dates have been sold out for some time, and when the news broke about our induction, it was too late to change them.
Jasper Carrot.
Yep, so he's going to be on the road with Jasper Carrot.
Wow.
So
because I'm thinking, okay, he's going to say Graham Norton, but I don't know who Jasper
Carrot is. You couldn't get another drummer for one night for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Of course you could. It just shows you what kind of a priority he puts on that garbage. Bravo to Bev Bevan. Not only did he play on the Born Again tour in Black Sabbath, but he told Jeff Lynne to fuck off in favor of this Jasper guy.
Jasper Carrot.
Yeah.
Great name.
It is a good name.
How is it spelled?
Jasper Carrot with an extra T. Two T's at the end.
So C-A-R-R-O-T-T.
Yep.
Love it.
Yep.
Couldn't possibly be any better.
No.
He sang on the second Vinnie Vincent Invasion album.
And they switched from Jack Noseworthy
to Jasper Carrot.
To Jasper Carrot. Oh, God. Well, hey, if you have any questions you'd like Nick and Chris to answer, or if you think this segment is worth pursuing again, let me know. You could find me on Facebook or Twitter or whatever. I'm around. I'm not hard to find. So look for us. I'll be there. I think that's good for 200, right? This is kind of a long episode.
So. I think we celebrated.
Well, I think one more time since Nick put all this effort in. A regular Jasper Carrot.
Man, that boy can sing.
All right, well, hey, we're out of time, but guess what? Next Monday, you're invited to the podcast event of the week, episode 201.
And that'll be Indie Expo week, right?
It will be. Geez, you know, I'm kind of forgetting my dates. Nick's birthday is this week. April 8th. What is it, Friday? Saturday. It's Saturday, April 8th. So that's coming up.
Okay.
Then the Saturday after is the Indie Expo.
Big month.
One big week after another here on Pot of Thunder. Yeah. So many milestones.
And next week we'll be back with the first episode of Podcast Rules the Game, right?
Oh, is that how it's working?
Is that what we're doing? Well, we figure 200 is enough with Kiss, right?
I've had enough.
Yeah.
I can't even listen to them anymore. I'm all Scorpions all the time
right now. This song we did today is enough to turn you off to Kiss forever. Might have to take this up with Bruce at the Indie Expo.
Yeah. Well, let's do that on April 15th, Saturday, April 15th, at the Wyndham Hotel in Indianapolis, Indiana. The 2017 Kiss Expo. Your chance to meet a Pot of Thunder superstar live in person. Probably Nick.
Probably.
He'll be in the Italian restaurant at the hotel. Probably not spending much time on the expo floor, but you'll be able to find him. And he will headbutt your pasta for $10, right? That's what we've established.
I will, yeah. Yep. I've decided that I'm going with that, yeah.
Because he headbutts the cymbal every week now since, what was that, like 197 or something? 190.
I'll headbutt your bolognese sauce. Bolognese, or however you say it.
That'll work. All right, well, we'll be back next week.
I think we should, well, edit this part out, but I think all that banter should be kept in sequence.
That we just had?
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine.